Good evening. So I thought I'd talk about how I made Going Your Way and how that kind of came about over probably a number of years now. I think the first voice memo that has any relation to it dates back to 2017. So it started with this voice memo. Was home for a couple of hours, so I just had the Casio running and I would select a different drum pattern and like kind of a random tempo and then write a series of chords to go with it. So that initial drum pattern became this voice memo, which became the basis of the whole form of Going Your Way. And I actually ended up using the original voice memo idea in its entirety as the basis for the whole song. So in the song is actually the original kind of memo of me recording the idea. If you listen to it closely, I think there's me kind of mumbling gibberish kind of lyrics and melody over it, which had also kind of been formed at the time. But I think it's so low that, I mean, it doesn't come out in the mix, but I think it is there if you do listen to it. Yeah, oh, it's pretty faint, so yeah, it was usable. So yeah, the kind of the form and the melody were kind of all done in that night, and then I turned it probably not that long after into this demo. Some programmed drums in there and me singing absolute intelligible lyrics. I also quite up in the mix, which ended up in the end of the song. You grabbed that same vocal track and threw it through this effect that mimics, it's called the Doppler, and it mimics the, like when a car comes past you quickly and how the pitch goes, like, and it slows down. Anyway, I put that on the vocals, so the vocals are doing this weird parsy pitch thing, which if I isolate it, sounds like this. Which is kind of funny in its own, but yeah, listening to it, I don't know, it was a weird kind of swirly world scenario that it created, and I liked that, so I kept that in. From there, it was kind of that idea for a while, and I would perform it live a couple of times with the band, and it got more and more strong as to what the identity of the song was. And I started getting a little bit more confident with the words that I was saying, but I was still somewhat making up, or I hadn't finalized lyrics. I would say a sentence that I'd gotten used to saying as a placeholder for the song, but I'd not gotten around to it yet, which is a pretty funny way to go about it when you're performing live. So I had phrases like, see if I can see any here, your mind lifts over your eyes, which became six wines in over your eyes, and are you gone to Norway also became are you going your way, Yeah, so just kind of phrases like that that had come out of gibberish kind of became the lyrics to a degree, and then I kind of filled in the blanks. And so when it became Are You Going Your Way, it became, the song took on the identity about being about separation from something and kind of processing that disconnect and kind of asking the question, oh, you're really going your way. Anyway, so it's funny, I lined up all the demo and then the first demo and then the first kind of rough demo with the band and then the pre-mixed version of the song and then the mixed version of the song. It's kind of like if I solo each one as we go along, it's like you can hear it coming out of the mud as you go through it, which I kind of thought was interesting. Kind of funny hearing it in those stages, and you start to notice the clear differences in between each one. I mean, there's obvious differences, but even between the premix kind of produced version that I finished doing with Yeldebert, who co-produced this song, and then the mix, it's like you hear some things like get quieter and you still hear some things like get more expansive. So yeah, I thought that was kind of interesting to listen to, maybe. So I kind of grouped the song into a few different groups of sounds. So yeah, let's see if there's anything interesting in the vocal.
Came up, I think that's enough. Tried to unsee what had given you up, boy.
Yeah, so it's pretty much just like a couple of delay sends and echo sends coming in and out, just swelling around. And I think at times I doubled the track, like here.
Are you gone to me? Wait here for some golden advice.
Yeah, I think that was Max's idea too. Thicken out some of those bits in the bigger sections to double it out, like that.
To stay here and guess all your life, climbing that tree.
Yeah, so there's the vocals in there, and then here's some vocal manipulated sounds. Oh yeah, I believe that just kind of comes in over the vocals as well as like a bit of a doubled, soupy, chocolatey sound.
In a while,
yeah, so that's that with the vocal track. There's a vocoder bit later on in the chorus.
stuck repeating the line, I hear calling your way.
Oh yeah, on the lead, it was the we used the Primal Tap in the Sound Toys or the effect rack, and it was feeding back into itself, and we just hit it on that bit, so it made that. And then kind of snaps back into focus. Yeah, that was enjoyable. Oh, is this like a sample?
The best of your time, I think that's walking for a while.
So just like light kind of pad stuff underneath there. And at the end, my voice kind of melts away and kind of this takes over.
That you get it in writing, you can.
And so that's just happens by turning the, I think we used an Alter, the Alter Boy plugin by Sound Toys, and you automate the formant, which is, not sure what the definition of formant is, but I believe it's just kind of the way that your mouth makes noises. So if you turn the formant up, it becomes more like this, and if you turn it down, it becomes more like that. But the pitch doesn't drop, which is interesting. So it can keep the tone of your voice can, well, the notes can stay the same, but it kind of gives the illusion that the pitch is dropping, but it's not actually. So yeah, that's kind of cool.
You're old enough, I think that's enough. Thoughts were clear, but even
yeah, just kind of that stuff. And then in the chorus, in the last chorus, it kind of builds up, and I got my sister Hannah to sing some extra vocals in there just to it not to feel like a choir of my own voice. I think that's why we did a lot of the manipulated vocal stuff around it as well, because I was kind of singing harmonies, but it kind of just felt like in a million choir thing of me. So getting those, making those textures slightly different, and just helped it feel like just a bit more of an interesting texture than just my own voice, like repeated and doubled, which I mean Freddie Mercury does well, but I don't know, I'm no Freddie Mercury, so yeah.
Are you calling your Are you going to stay here and guess all your life?
There's the guitar tracks as well. So yeah, there's a bit of playing around with like dipping it into this chasm of like kind of shaky reverb, and it kind of gets a bit distorted, and then kind of snapping back to focus again. So yeah, that was with the baritone guitar that Sticky recorded. So yeah, all these kind of peaks and troughs. But yeah, we tracked it we did two takes and tracked it in stereo and had it on left and right. It just makes it feel really 3D and which is cool. It kind of sits all around your head, and it was a good vibe recording it in stereo. That was Sticky's idea, actually. And then there was the Whirly. So the Whirly is literally just the iPhone memo in combination with another Wurlitzer that I doubled it with, just because I don't know, I wanted, similar to how the guitars were treated with the two takes, I kind of wanted this feeling of kind of some kind of a different quality to the sound. It wasn't just such a mono sound, maybe there was two things going on, and they're slightly different from each other. Yeah, so it's kind of just like, I don't know, it sounds like just a little bit more tinkly around your head. Here's the drum group, which is made up of just a couple of electronic drum sounds, and then the drum take that my drummer Jesse did that we recorded at our kind of rehearsal studio in Collingwood. This was my friend David's hollow body Vox bass. So there's those peaks and troughs again, the same stuff kind of that happened to the guitar on the drums and other things. Yeah, so that's that, and it obviously starts with this, which is the demo kind of thing from the start. I like that the song kind of sounds like it's a voice memo at the start, because it is the two voice memo elements that it began with, and I like that they've been kept, you know, in there, and it's quite literally a progression into the idea, to the fully fleshed out idea. There's also these little effect sounds that come in. Some other things. It's a little keys pad thing to kind of pad out the backing vocals underneath that. A couple of rising sounds, we called it. As the swells in the chorus, there was these things going on. Which you wouldn't probably pick in there, but yeah, if you turn it up a bit louder. Flip sound. Yeah, so it's just like little intricate things, which I love that Yeldabert did a lot of those kind of little tiny details, which was great that he cared so much about the song. And was really easy to kind of talk with. I mean, we lived together at the time, so it was very easy just to spend time with this and, work away at it slowly. We didn't have to do it in organized sessions. It was nice to be able to just be like, oh, I had this idea about a little section in the song. Can we try it? And then we'd just find some time after dinner or, you know, in the next half an hour when we were not doing something both at home. So that was nice. Underneath it all, as well as the crickets that were in the original voice memo. I mean, you've heard crickets before, but yeah. You can kind of hear them in the background there. Yeah, so that's it. This became. yeah, so that's it. That's all the bits that went into it. If you have any questions about the song, ask me. I'll answer them.